You may delay, but time will not, Benjamin Franklin had once said. This is certainly true in the context of the International Maritime Organization's Global Sulfur Limit Rule for Marine Fuels, which starts January 1, 2020. Some 60% of the bunkers will have to switch from HSFO to 0.5% sulfur overnight, entailing significant costs and calling for extensive planning among ship owners, charterers, ship crew, refiners, as well as others in the maritime industry. I'm Surabhi Sahu, and this is Insight Conversation. Today we have with us Jerome Leprince-Ringuet, Managing Director at Total Marine Fuels Global Solutions. Hi Jerome, thanks for joining us today. So, the IMO 2020 deadline is drawing closer. How well prepared do you think is the maritime industry for this rule?
Hi Surabhi, and thank you for inviting me. Indeed, it's important that we keep speaking and preparing for this IMO 2020. It is going to be a disruptive change for both shipping industry, but as well for oil industry. It's an 85% decrease in the sulfur content of bunker fuels. As you said, how prepared is the shipping industry? I would say time for decision is over now. All ship owners have made their choices. Should they go for low sulfur fuels? Should they go for high sulfur fuels for vessels equipped with scrubbers? Or should they choose liquefied natural gas, LNG? So I think now it is the time to prepare the switchover. And the switchover, it is important to state that it's not the usual buy and sell relationship between the ship operators and the suppliers. It needs to be prepared through a more partnership-like relationship to plan the change and to prepare the crews for the change. So this is important.
So that brings me to my next question. With these changes ahead, what do you think will the bunker fuel mix look like post-2020?
Well, it's interesting to see that the major fuel coming next year will definitely be the low sulfur fuel. When you look at the trends in the scrubber installation on board the vessel, we forecast that it will represent between 10 and 20% of the market, meaning that the remaining part will be in majority this low sulfur fuel very low sulfur fuel, VLSFO, the 0.5% fuel that will appear on the market later this year. So this is the two main fuels, but there is a third one that will ramp up rapidly, which is the LNG indeed, which is a fuel of choice, I would say, for complying with both short-term regulation, the sulfur regulation, but as well as matching expectation of future regulations such as nitrogen oxides, and such as particulate matter, and being as well a low-carbon fuel, so matching some of the expectation of the long-term roadmap for greenhouse gas emission in the shipping industry. So in a nutshell, major fuel will be low sulfur fuel, and the remaining part will be high sulfur fuel and LNG.
So you mentioned that LNG has the potential to be a marine fuel for the future. What are the challenges for its uptake in the future?
It is a fuel that is matching future regulation, but it is not sufficient to be selected. It needs also to be available, and it is available on a large scale because you have LNG terminals throughout the world. It is transported safely. It has been the case for the last 50 years. The strongest point, I would say, in the short term is that it is economically viable. So having said that, we are very optimistic, very positive about LNG being having a bright future in the fuel mix of the shipping industry. Now it's time to work on a few items to foster the development of this fuel. One of these is the standards on LNG bunkering. It is an emerging fuel, so the standards in the industry are not yet stabilized. So we are working hard on that within industry bodies such as the Society of Gas as a Marine Fuel, SGMF, which is gathering industry experts to set the standards in any of the technical aspects of the bunkering of LNG, like I would say transfer system, manifold, safety aspects. We also need to raise the level of preparation in the ports, so that in any port and any port state, I would say, needs to develop the regulations, local regulation, I would say, licensing schemes, the fiscal schemes, the authorization scheme within the port, so that there is clarity and the market needs visibility and clarity about that. So these are two important items. And the third one I would like to mention is that we need to raise the awareness of the shipping industry on the LNG as a propelling fuel. We need to be focused on the training of the crews, on raising the level of training of skills of the crews on board these vessels that will be LNG propelled, in order to have enough talents, enough skills in the crew matrix of the vessel to cope with this new fuel. So these are the three main items I would like to stress. I would finish saying that there has been a debate on whether the bunkering, LNG bunkering infrastructure was sufficient or not. And just one point that I see in the market is that many major bunker suppliers in many ports have engaged in bunkering infrastructure developments. And today, we foresee that in the next couple of years, all the major ports will be equipped with the service. So meaning that for a ship owner who wishes to select LNG, it's now not the question of the bunkering infrastructure. It's a question of engaging with those suppliers. And we as Total, we are definitely ready to enter this new era of the LNG being a fuel of choice for the ship owners.
Zooming in on Total, how's your marine segment gearing up for IMO 2020?
We as Total, we took it very seriously since 2016, when the decision for the IMO 2020 was definitely made by the IMO. It was in October 2016. We very rapidly made key decisions, strategic decisions. So the first one is confirm to our customers, to the industry, that we will be ready, we will be able to deliver any solution they would require in 2020, any fuel and any other solutions, including services to the shipping industry, like hedging services or other of that kind. So we renamed our company Total Marine Fuels Global Solutions at that time, early 2017, to make it clear. At the same time, we launched two programs. The first one was a comprehensive new product development program with our research and development centers to develop the new low sulfur fuel that we would sell in the market in 2020. I'm quite proud to say that we were pioneer after our first development phase, pioneer in the first VLSFO trials on board deep sea vessels. So we had one in 2018, which was rolled out on a big vessel sailing the Europe-Asia trade, and that was very successful in a way. So we are quite ready on that aspect. So this is the first key element of our roadmap to 2020. The second one was to develop and to build and develop a team for the development of LNG bunkering. So for that, we indeed leverage on the Total as a group, knowledge, expertise in LNG. And I want to recall that we are the second player worldwide in LNG. So we have many skilled talents, and we gathered them in within a team that has been developing very actively and very well LNG bunkering, both technically and commercially. So these are the two main aspects of our strategy. And I can say that today, because we are not very far from 2020, and actually it will start a bit earlier than 2020 for the sake of the switchover, I can say, yeah, Total is now prepared, is ready for 2020.
Singapore is the world's largest bunkering port. So would you tell us what Total is doing to promote LNG bunkering in Singapore?
Definitely, Singapore is central to our strategy. Central to our strategy as a bunker supplier, but central specifically to our strategy in LNG bunkering. We are headquartered in Singapore. We have a special relationship with Singapore, and we know that Singapore is the first, by far, bunkering hub in the world, with approximately 20% of the bunker market being in Singapore. So there is, for us, no doubt that in the future, Singapore will remain a major bunkering hub and will deserve to be a very important LNG bunkering hub. The other point is Singapore has worked, very well on developing at the early stage the LNG bunkering infrastructure and LNG bunkering licensing scheme. So we were quite glad to see that and to work closely with the MPA on that. At the same time, you don't need in an emerging market, I would say, which is small at the very beginning, you need to control one thing is the logistic cost that the customer will pay in the end to make LNG the cheapest. So what we decided is to partner with another key player here in the LNG market, which is Pavilion Energy, to partner to develop together the logistic infrastructure needed for the bunkering of LNG. And we have done so by co-sharing LNG bunkering vessel has been launched a few months ago. Construction is now ongoing in Sembcorp Marine Shipyard. So we are developing together this bunkering vessel, 12,000 cubic meters, that will start operations in early 2021.
That's great. Thanks for your insight, Jerome. And thanks for watching. Remember that you can join the conversation on Twitter with the hashtag #SPGPlattsInsight.